Welcome to the Space Jam. Here's your chance. Do your dance at the Space Jam. All right.
Now, one thing I really want your generation to embrace is that the Earth is a closed system.
The Earth is a closed system.
We cannot leave the Earth. There's no place to go.
This is not, I'm not preaching, see? I'm not saying this is what you ought to do. I'm simply pointing out a state of affairs that is so. There's no moralism in this whatsoever. It's simply pointing out, like, if you put your hand into the fire, you'll get burned. You can get burned if you want to. That's okay. But if you, so happens that you don't want to get burned, and you don't put your hand in the fire.
I don't believe these people even were on the Challenger. I was in the classroom, I think I was about 12 years old, and I saw this explode on TV. They put it on. You know, there was a teacher on board, Krista McAuliffe, and I was led to believe that all seven people died in the disaster. I think the first one that came out was that Judith was still alive, now a professor at Yale University. Same name, Judith Resnick. This guy here looks like it could be this guy. His name's Claude. I don't know, they have the same last name. They're both Michael J. Smith. He's at UW University now. Like this guy here, you know, with the weird eye here, looks like he could be the same man to me 30 years later. This guy's Francis Richard Scobie, and this guy's Richard Scobie. I don't know. I just can see it being possible, okay?
Nescience, from the Latin verb nesciere, means to not know because knowledge was absent or unattainable. Ignorance comes from the Latin verb ignorare. Ignorance does not mean you are stupid. It means to not know, even though necessary information is present, because that information has been willfully refused or disregarded by you.
This is a special report from Channel 4 News. Good morning, I'm Kent Shocknick, and Space Shuttle Challenger is just a few seconds away from blasting off from the Kennedy Space Center near Cape Canaveral, Florida. Let's take a look right now.
7, 6, we have main engine start, 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff.
Solid rocket boosters kicking in.
The 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
This shuttle mission will launch. My God.
1 minute 15.
There's been an explosion.
Velocity 2,900 feet per second, altitude 9 nautical miles, downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
This is not standard. This is not something that is planned, of course. I can see a solid rocket booster has broken away from Shuttle Challenger. That's what you're looking at in the middle of your screen. I cannot see the shuttle itself.
In 1986, the Shuttle Challenger exploded about 74 seconds after takeoff, killing all seven astronauts inside. Or did it? It turns out that six of the seven are still alive and kicking today. Ellison Onizuka claims to be his identical twin brother, Claude. Yeah, I've got an identical twin brother, Claude, too. The Challenger pilot, Mickey Smith, hasn't even bothered changing his name. He's now Professor Michael J. Smith of University of Wisconsin. Now, Krista McAuliffe was a bit of a sneaky one. She was the Challenger payload specialist, quite famous for being a teacher. It turns out, during her astronaut days, she was using her middle name, Krista. And now she goes by her first name, Sharon. And she's a Syracuse law professor. The Challenger commander, Francis Richard Scobie, is now Dick Scobie, which sounds like a rather unpleasant disease, CEO of Cows and Trees Limited. Judith Resnick, the Challenger mission specialist, again, hasn't even bothered changing her name. She's a professor at Yale Law. And finally, Ronald McNair, another Challenger mission specialist, claims to be his identical twin brother, Carl McNair. What are the odds?
Part of the team, even though she was not a trained astronaut.
She knows
where we're going to be standing, how busy it's going to be, where she can help, where we need our space. And she has learned an awful lot and become a team
weird member. Lady with scale and swords and blindfolds, or Grecian goddess, or warrior princess, or whatever it is. What makes it legible? And so one of the questions in the book is to puzzle about both its history and the legibility of this, which is a marker, and of course, this local county court.
Feed your mind.
Fourth stage, push. Engine arm is empty.
Okay, I'm going to get to pro.
99, proceeded. 3, 2, 1, ignition. Right away, Houston. Bet you're good.
But wait, hold on. If this is footage of the crew leaving the moon and making the journey back to Earth, then who did they leave behind to film their craft take off? And wait, don't you think those colorful emissions on takeoff look kind of fake? I haven't seen any subsequent rockets produce these sort of dazzling colors. I suppose they did admit that they had lost all their data from the mission. Houston, we have a big problem.
Okay, well, there's a big problem with the blue marble, and I'm going to zoom in here and show you what the problem is. These are all composite images where they are really not very good at Photoshop because they're using the Photoshop clone tool to replicate clouds. This cloud is a copy of this cloud. See the formations? They're identical. Identical formations. These right here, side by side, side by side. See this kind of W-looking shape right here, replicated right here. This cloud is exactly the same as that cloud. You know, same clouds right there, and same thing on the other side of the world. They got the same thing going on. They got careless here. Look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the same formations replicated right there. These two replicated, same exact formations right here. This right here is clone of that right there. I mean, really? So you're telling me that we could take pictures of Jupiter and Saturn, huge, massive planets, and now we're out going to Pluto, but we don't have one legitimate picture of the Earth from space? That's not a composite? Click on this picture right here. Supposedly the same mission, same guys that took the picture, the most famous picture of our Earth. I'm going to do save image as, and let's see, Apollo Moon. Let's call it Apollo Moon 17. And I'm going to open that in Photoshop. And if those of you think this technical difficulty was planned and think I'm scamming you, go do it for yourself. Because you're going to find the exact same thing. I got nothing to hide here. This is live on the air, okay? I'm going to zoom in on the Earth in Photoshop. You see the Earth? Go to Image, Adjust, Levels. And I'm going to bring the levels over here. And I'm going to bring the levels up. Uh-oh. What is that? Why is there a square box around the Earth allegedly taken from the scientists on the moon in Apollo 17? And people wonder why I don't trust NASA. That's why I don't trust NASA.
Just another example of NASA faking space. Take a look here at this supposed image of Jupiter. Nothing more than CGI fakery. The supposed auroras towards the north. Let's take a look here. Again, at NASA's official website, where it states Hubble captures vivid auroras in Jupiter's atmosphere. Here's the problem. The date of June 30th, 2016. Now take a look at this. Another so-called official image of Jupiter. This one's from back in 2014. You see the problem here? Now let's take a closer look at the supposed two images provided from NASA of Jupiter. Here's the problem. Again, 2016, 2014. What's the difference here? Well, the difference is they added the supposed auroras on the north, and this is nothing but a Christmas tree. Give me a break. Take a look here. I mean, all the clouds are in the same exact position. Just the 2016 image is a bit, I would say, darker. It's a bit lighter in 2014. Here's a side-by-side. People can't see what's taking place here with NASA. Nothing more than fakery. I mean, give me a break. This is a complete insult. You have a brain in your head.
And you can tell it's real because it looks so fake, honestly.